are the only things that can be known things that are material. What I mean by material things here are things that that extend in space or that respond to the laws of physics and chemistry. Maybe that's the simplest way of putting it. I mean stuff in its most fundamental sense, matter and energy. And of course, you know from Einstein that there's kind of a relationship between the two. And one can be converted to the other, but neither can be created or destroyed. And is this the fundamental reality of the universe? Those who claim that matter is the fundamental reality of the universe are called materialists. Doesn't mean they're spending a lot of money on foolish things. It means that it's a metaphysical view, which is a view of what exists, which says that the only thing that does exist are those things that are physical. And naturalism is kind of packed in there because naturalism is the view that these physical things operate according to a certain set of laws and principles that are inviolable. And they're inviolable because there's nothing outside of the natural universe that can violate them. And so the question then is it true that only those things can be known and everything else we believe is by faith? Well, the question says supernatural be known, but I'm going to use the term supranatural because that would include everything outside of the natural. Supra, everything outside of the natural, including what we would call the supernatural. So it's all inclusive in that regard, because I think that's really the issue. Can we know things that are not part of the natural realm as in physical material realm as I just described them? And the answer is, amazingly, we can actually know those things with some of those things at least, with more confidence than we can know the natural realm. Let me just take a very, very simple thing. According to materialist approach to knowledge, empiricism is kind of the way we know things. Our five senses apprehend things in our natural surroundings and give us information about the world. Okay, so those are things we can know. There it is, right there. The computer's sitting right in front of me. See, I know the computer's here, and I'm sitting in this room. Okay, well, let me tell you something else that I know. I also know that I exist. I know that, I think, irrefutably. And it was Rene Descartes who famously said, "I think, therefore I am." And I think that's pretty straightforward. Or my version is, "I fish, therefore I am." But in any event, if you're a thinking thing, reflecting on whether you exist, you realize that you cannot exist. You cannot not exist and still be thinking about your existence. So that you are thinking about whether or not you exist is proof that you exist. So it is not possible for me to be thinking about whether or not I exist and I be non-existent. I hope you see that. Here's the key, though. My existence, not my existence as a physical being, that's a different step, but my existence itself, however I may be manifest in existence, my existence is something that I know and I cannot be mistaken about. Now, I think I'm also, at least part of me, is physical. How do I know that? Because I have physical senses that apprehend that. I have physical senses that apprehend the computer in the room around me and the enforcer sitting over to the side there listening patiently. Now, here's my question. Is it possible for my senses to deceive me? And of course, the answer immediately to that is yes, of course it is. People are mistaken all the time by their senses. I'm not saying that the senses can never be trusted. I'm just simply saying they are not perfect. It is possible to be mistaken about one's senses. So now I have two awarenesses. I have an awareness that I exist, and I have a second awareness that I exist as a physical human being. The first awareness I cannot possibly be mistaken by. The second awareness I could be mistaken by. That means, at least in this instance, I could be more confident of my knowledge about something that is supranatural than something that is in the natural world. And by the way, there are lots of different examples of this kind of thing. The laws of logic are an example of something that does not extend in space, has no weight, does not respond chemically or to the laws of physics, but is real and we employ it all the time. So that's a reality that is we can know directly that is not physical. It's supranatural. It's above or beyond or outside of the natural realm. So not only is knowledge in the non-natural realm possible, it's essential to even know something in the natural realm. It comes first. And as I said, I think we can know things with more confidence that are non-natural than that are natural. That should elevate the supranatural elements, possibly supernatural claims, well into the field of knowledge and not merely believed by faith or philosophical speculation as if that's a big nothing. No, this is really substantive. This is significant. Incidentally, one postscript here, for those empiricists out there who think, well, science is the thing that tells you all truth, strictly speaking, on empiricist terms, and you can go back to Kant for this if you want, Immanuel Kant, K-A-N-T, who said basically you can't know the phenomenal world. That is the world out there that we are perceiving with our senses. All that we, according to him, are in touch with is our sensory responses. We are not in touch with the world as it is in itself. So even from an empiricist perspective, you still can't get out to the real physical world. You're still stuck with these impressions that, which themselves, impressions that is, are supra-natural. They are not fixed in the physical world, even on the empiricist characterization. So you can have plenty of confidence that it is possible to know the supranatural world, and if supra, then super as well, at least in principle.